Well, it's good to have everybody here on this Friday night here in Northeast Louisiana. It's good to have you visitors here, and we're just so grateful and thankful to have Brother David and Sister Martha back with us.
Amen.
My wife and I have thoroughly enjoyed them. They came in late yesterday afternoon, and Brother David and I have enjoyed some fellowship, and all four of us eating a little more than I should have, but at any rate, we're so thankful to have them. And we're thankful to have you wherever in the world you're at. Join us on Facebook as well as YouTube. Are you happy to be in the house of the Lord?
Amen.
Oh, one more time. Are you happy to be in the house
Amen.
Of the Lord?
Amen.
I'm going to ask you a question, and I'm going to turn it over to Brother David rather quickly, but I want to ask you a question tonight. It's been on my heart. Why did you come tonight? Don't answer that out loud. But I'm going to ask each one of us to search your heart. Allow the Holy Spirit to search your heart. Why did you come tonight? If it's to hear great singing, that's a good answer, but it's an incomplete answer. If you came to hear good preaching, that's a good answer, but it's an incomplete answer. And I begin to search my heart this afternoon. And let me tell you why we're here tonight. It goes back to 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14. If my people, the Lord would say, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven.
Amen.
I will forgive their sin and heal their land.
Amen.
God only knows
Amen.
How much our land needs healing. Amen?
Amen.
And all of God's word is precious. Jesus would talk about every jot, every tittle, every small little word or letter or pronunciation in the Bible is very precious because it's God's word. But in that verse that I just read you, let me tell you why we're here. There's three words in there. Seek my face.
Amen. Amen.
Seek my face. That's why we're here tonight, to worship him through the word, through song, to praise his name, but we're seeking him tonight. Amen.
Amen.
Brother David, would you come? And
praise the Lord. I love that. That's what we're here for. We want to encounter the presence of the Lord. Amen.
Yes.
We want to seek his face. Good to be here tonight. Always a privilege and an honor. I have the privilege of coming here once a month and being with you all. And it's, of course, wonderful to have my wife, Martha. And I know we're going to have a blessed time in the Lord. So let's pray. And we're going to let the worship team lead us into the presence of God. Amen. Father, we love you. We thank you for this time that we have to be together, Father. Together in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for the privilege that we have. We thank you for your presence, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
And Father, we're just very humbly coming before you and asking you that you would move in a mighty way in our midst, Lord, that our hearts would be prepared to worship you. Lord, that we would be ready to lift up the name of Jesus, that name that is above every other name. But Lord, we declare our love for you, Father. We thank you that you sent your Son to die for our sin, Lord God. We commit this time into your hands. Commit these three services over these next 3 days, Lord God, and ask that you would move in a mighty way, Lord. We know that you're able. Father, we give you the praise and the honor and the glory, and we say it in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Stand and worship the Lord tonight. I mean, he's ready for a blessing.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. I stay ready. What a time we're going to have when we get over there at Heaven's Jubilee. Sing it with us.
Where's hope that morning we shall see Jesus in the air? How in every human your lives to share? How rejoice the miracle when the saints go by? And all that you believe yonder in the sky. Oh, what's happening? Oh, what's happening on that morning when we all share? Glory, hallelujah, when we meet our best to say.
used you and made you an encourager.
Yes.
Glory to God. If you knew me back then, you wouldn't like me so much. I found a better way. Amen. Oh, I found a better way. Riding past for my feet. My heart was yours so sweet. I found a better way. Since I found the church. I'm not afraid to
free. Paid the price for all my guilty.
Yes. tasted of the goodness of God.
Yes, I'm gonna see of the goodness of my God.
Yes. Yes.
Up your name in this place, Lord God. Lord, we ask right now that your presence, your manifest presence, would fill this place, fill every heart, fill every life, Lord God. Lord, that you would touch tonight, that you would heal, Father, you would move in this place. Lord, we've not come just to spectate, Lord, we've not come just to gather for another church service, Lord. We want to believe you for big and mighty things tonight, Father. We worship you, Lord God. Thank you for your presence, Lord God.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah.
Thank you, Father.
Bring out a situation.
Glory to
you.
Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Father.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord. Just praise your name. Just lift up your hands and worship him. We're not in any hurry tonight. Hallelujah. We want to encounter his presence tonight. The reality of who he is in the midst of the people. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father, that we have the privilege as your children to gather together in your presence because of what your Son has done for us on Calvary's cross. We can have the presence of God, your presence in our midst, Lord God. And Father, we don't take that for granted tonight. We thank you for that great privilege. We thank you for that opportunity. It's a great honor and a great privilege that we have as your children, Lord.
Yes, yes.
Hallelujah. We just declare our love for you tonight, O God. Declare our love for you, and we thank you. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for what you have done, Lord. Thank you for that precious blood. Father, we commit the remainder of this service into your hands, Lord God. And Father, we ask for the grace and the help of your Spirit, the anointing of your Spirit to help us, Lord, to minister your word. Give us the words to say, Lord God. Quicken us, quicken our minds, quicken our hearts. Father, give your people ears to hear and give them eyes to see, Lord. Grant them a spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of the Son of the living God. Make Jesus more real to us. Tonight, Lord God. And Father, we'll thank you for that, giving you the praise and the honor and the glory.
Yes.
We say it in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Amen.
Lord.
We're having church.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I want to make mention that if you enjoyed Martha's music, we've got a few CDs of her music. There's also a teaching CD that I have done on prayer that is available as well after this. So after the service, if you want to take a look at that, it's something most of you probably have them. But if not, take a look and see if it's something that you want to avail yourself to. I know it will be a blessing to you. I want us to turn our Bibles. I was to 2 Chronicles chapter 16. I was hesitant to. This mic feels weird. I don't know if it's going. Does it sound like it's going in and out, or are we good? Okay. I was hesitant to go here because I preached this actually in Family Worship Center last Sunday night, and I figured, well, you know, I'm sure there's probably a good number of you that tuned in. How many of you did happen to tune into the service last Sunday night? So only a couple. So good. So the Lord knew. And so I felt to go this direction, but I was hesitant to do it. But now I know that it's the right direction to go. And then after Pastor got up here and he quoted 2 Chronicles 7:14, that was kind of a confirmation to me. So I want to look at these two passages of Scripture, 2 Chronicles 16:9. And then we're going to look at 2 Chronicles 7:14. I'm going to go ahead and, well, I'll tell you what, I'm going to share this first before I read either one of them. I want to share with you a dream, two dreams that I had actually. This was about, I guess 10 or 12 years ago. I was actually preparing to teach in our camp meeting a three-part series on prayer. This was back in 2013, I think it was, maybe 2014. And Martha and I had gone on vacation. We went to the beach for a few days. And during that time, I was just sort of praying as to how, you know, what the Lord wanted me to share, how I needed to prepare for this camp meeting. And I went to sleep one particular night, and I had two dreams that night. And I'm not a dreamer. I don't, you know, have a dream every other night and say, you know, the Lord gave me this dream, like some people. And most of the time, it's not the Lord. I can probably say 8 or 10 times, maybe in my 40 years of serving the Lord, that I can say beyond a shadow of a doubt that I knew that the Lord, these dreams were of the Lord. But these two were, they were very brief. And I'll share with you the first dream that I had. We were, Martha and I were in a room, and there were windows in that room. And I just happened to, I was looking outside and I saw the sun and the moon very rapidly going across the window, very rapidly. And man, I thought, you know, that's strange. In fact, I think I even in the dream, I said to Martha, that's kind of odd, isn't it? That's a little weird. Of course it's a little weird. The sun and the moon moving at such a rapid manner. And then about the time that I said those words, all of a sudden, the room just began to violently turn and twirl, and we were flinging and flying around that room just out of control. There was nothing that we could do. It was a totally out of control situation. And I remember thinking when we were out of control flying around that room that I this came to my mind, this is the end. This is what came to my mind. This is the end. And I woke up. And I pondered it for a few minutes. I couldn't really, Lord, what is this? What are you telling me? And so I just, you know, I went back to sleep. And pretty much immediately, as soon as I fell back asleep, I had another dream. And in this particular dream, myself and one of the other ministers on our staff, it was a room, and there were two twin beds. He was in one twin bed, I was in another twin bed, and we were sound asleep, and Brother Swaggart was in the room. He was sitting in a chair, there was a television camera, and it was a makeshift kind of a situation, and he said this, he said, turn your Bibles to 2 Chronicles 7:14, and of course, you know, I woke up, we both did, woke up startled, you know, here we were sound asleep. And we hear that voice, and you know, turn your Bible to 2 Chronicles 7:14. And I remember in my mind, right before I woke up, for some reason, I know I'm very familiar with 2 Chronicles 7:14. I know it by heart. I'm also very familiar with 2 Chronicles 16:9. But when he said that, my mind went to 2 Chronicles 16:9, and I woke up. And, you know, I just sort of, Lord, what is this? What are you saying? And I couldn't really make much sense out of it. But then over time, I just sort of began, you know, I was praying about it. Lord, what are you saying? What are you speaking to me? What is the message that you're trying to tell me? And I feel like the Lord began to give me some understanding of it. The first dream had to do with this, that what is happening in our world is, it is out of our control. The spinning room, nothing we could do. It is totally out of our control. All that's going on spiritually, politically, economically, socially, there's nothing that we can do in the natural. Okay? So this brings us to the second dream that the Lord gave me, and that of prayer. That of prayer. Yeah. And the way the Lord brought these two together to me was a little, when I told you, shared with you, that he said 2 Chronicles 7:14. My mind went to 2 Chronicles 16:9. What he was doing is bringing those two together to me. And there was a message in that for me to give. And so that's what I'm going to share with you tonight. And, you know, I feel in the hour that we are living in light of what is taking place in our world today, we need to be a people who enter into and get serious about the place of prayer.
Amen.
Amen. When we look at the direction, first of all, the direction that the church as a whole is going, contrary to God's way, the church is carnal. The church is not going the way that God has lined out in his word according to the new covenant. It's not going that way as a whole. But then we look at our nation as well, and not only our nation, but the nations of the world. And the Antichrist spirit that is evident in the world, in our nation, and is becoming more and more prominent in our nation, and I'm afraid that it's even filtering into the church. And I say Antichrist, oh, they'll talk about Jesus, and they'll tell stories about Jesus and quote scripture, but they're not presenting the truth of the gospel. So if there was ever a time that we as God's people needed to pray, and if there was ever a time that things were out of control, amen? You know, we can do all that we can. We can vote for another candidate, and we pray and hope that another candidate gets in office. 4 more years of what we have, we won't have a nation left. But then that's great. You know, we hope that that happens. But that in itself is really not the answer. It's not the answer. Politics, a different political party, a different leader, all of that is important. But we really need to get to the root of the problem. And the root of the problem really is rests upon the shoulders of the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're not being what God has called us to be as the church. In fact, that is why our nation is in the condition that is in, because as the church goes, so goes the nation and the world. And that's what we are seeing. So anyhow, if there was ever a time that we needed to get serious about the place of prayer, serious about our consecration, our lives consecrated to the Lord and His way, and serious about the place of prayer, it's today. It's today. We are in the last of the last days. Time is short. The trump of God could sound at any time. Jesus Christ is coming back for His church. And we need to be ready. And we need to prepare as many people as we can to be ready. We need to gather as many to come in as we can. Amen.
Yes.
As many lost in preparing the church for the coming of the Lord. So I want to look at these passages a little bit. I don't want to belabor anything. I don't want to keep you too long, but we'll bring out some points here. 2 Chronicles 16:9. It's always been one of my favorite verses. It's so powerful. When I read it, you will understand why. For the eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show Himself strong. Notice this. In the behalf of them whose heart is perfect toward Him. I'm just going to read that portion of it. That's what I want to deal with. The eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the whole earth to show Himself strong in the behalf of them whose heart is perfect toward Him. If you could get this picture that God right now, His eyes are roaming throughout His church, throughout the earth, and He's simply looking for hearts that are right, that are, as it says here, perfect before Him. And I want to deal with that idea of having a perfect heart before the Lord. It literally means this. It means to be complete. It means to be friendly toward God. You have a perfect heart when you are friendly toward God. It means to be whole, to be at peace as a result of embracing God's way or God's covenant. So the idea is this. We don't have a perfect heart on the basis of how we perform, what we can do according to our righteousness and our efforts to be holy and to be perfect and to do everything right. The Bible says that God looks at our righteousness as what? As filthy rags.
Right.
It's not according to us. So having a perfect heart, it's almost like an oxymoron because, you know, the Bible also says that our hearts are desperately wicked, deceitful above all things. Who can know it? The Bible said, Jesus said that out of the heart of man proceeds adulteries and fornication. In other words, that's what our heart is and what it produces. That is the heart of man. It's like a sin factory that produces these things. So how can we have a perfect heart? And there's other places in Scripture. It talks about in Matthew chapter 5, Jesus, He said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. So there we see a pure heart. Blessed are the pure in heart. In Hebrews chapter 10, Paul said, if in fact Paul wrote Hebrews, he said, let us draw near with a true heart. So here we see that what God is looking for is a perfect heart, a pure heart, and a true heart. So how do we attain, and how are we able to have this perfect heart, this pure heart, and this true heart? To where when God looks at us, he says, you are perfect before me. Your heart is perfect. Your heart is pure as if you have never sinned. Your heart is true as if you have never told a lie or as if there is never a falsehood in you. How do we attain that? Well, you can't in yourself. You cannot be that within yourself. The whole idea, I'll just say this very simply so you can understand it, to have a perfect heart, a pure heart, and a true heart, it has to do with where your faith is.
Amen.
You are friendly toward God, listen, when you embrace His covenant. When you submit to what God has provided and what God has given to you, of course, under the old, it was the old covenant that the children of Israel were to adhere to. Under the new now, we are not under the old, we are under the new covenant, and that is what we are now to give ourselves over to and submit ourselves to, is the new covenant, which is Jesus Christ, who He is, and what He did on Calvary's cross.
Amen.
So to the degree that we submit ourselves to God's redemption plan, to that degree do you have a perfect, pure, and true heart. And God will look at you and say, there is no guile in you, no guilt in you, no sin in you. Amen. Simply because you submitted to and embraced my way, my covenant, you accepted my Son, and you have submitted to my redemption plan, you have yielded yourself to me, you have presented yourself to God, a living sacrifice, and because you have done that, even though you're all messed up within yourself, how many know we're all messed up?
Amen.
Yes.
All right, you all are angels. I'll just, you know, preach to myself. I'm all messed up. We are. We are. We don't realize how messed up we really are. We're a mess, folks. We're a mess. But when we submit to God's plan, God's way, God's covenant, what God provided for us, then God says, you're perfect. Your heart is pure as if you have never sinned. You have a true heart as if there is no falsehood in you, because you simply submitted yourself to my redemption plan. So what God is calling His church to, the first part of that, or that first dream that I had, is He's calling His church to be consecrated to His redemption plan. That's what He's calling His church to. That's the only way that we can be what God has called us to be and be the prayer warriors, the intercessors, those who will stand in the gap and be the testimony and be the witnesses that God has called us to be when we submit to the redemption plan of God. So when God's eyes run to and fro throughout the earth, what He's looking for is faith.
Yes.
And not the faith that you hear most preachers preach about, that's not biblical faith at all. Faith goes back to the cross.
Amen.
Faith goes
yes.
back to the
yes.
blood.
Yes.
Faith goes back to Jesus Christ, who He is, and what He did on that cross. Amen. So that's what God is looking for when He scans over this earth, when He scans over this, even this little congregation here. He's looking for faith. Those who have submitted completely and entirely to His redemption plan, so that God can do what? As in, what a powerful promise.
Yes, yes.
He's looking. His eyes are roaming throughout the whole earth to show Himself strong. How many of you want God to show Himself strong?
Yeah.
Amen. Strong in the behalf. He wants to be strong in you.
Yes.
He wants to be powerful in you. He wants to manifest himself to you and in you and be real to you. But you've got to have this perfect heart.
Hallelujah.
You've got to have this submission to his redemption plan. If you don't have that, then you don't have that benefit. You don't have that blessing. You don't have the strength of the Lord. So that's what he's looking for. God longs to show himself strong on the behalf of his children.
Amen.
He longs to, I read somewhere that it means something along these lines, that God wants to invest himself in you. It's Christ in you, the hope of glory. If you want to be a true witness and a testimony in this earth, you've got to position yourself by faith in the finished work of Calvary, which allows Christ to live in you, the hope of glory, amen, yes, by the power of the Holy Spirit. You've heard me say this many times. That's what Christianity is.
Amen.
It's not about you.
Amen.
It's not about you. Listen, it's not about you trying to act like Jesus.
Come on.
It's you submitting to God's redemption plan and allowing Jesus to live his life in you.
Yes.
Paul said his death works in me that his life also might be made manifest in my mortal flesh.
Right.
That's the goal, folks, as Christians. We want Christ to live in us.
Yes.
So you got Christians running around. You know what we are? We're actors. You know what an actor is? The definition of a hypocrite is an actor. So we've got hypocrites that are trying to act like Jesus instead of submitting to the redemption plan of God and yielding to him and presenting themselves to him so that Christ can live in them and they can be like Jesus.
Amen.
Instead of outwardly trying to act like him. You know, I don't see him that much anymore, but they used to have these bracelets, you know, that WWJD. What would Jesus do? The idea being this, man, we got to try to imitate Jesus. We got to do what Jesus would do. And that's good in itself. You know, that's not a bad statement. But the idea or the way that we go about it in the flesh is trying to imitate in the strength of our flesh.
Right.
That's what's bad about it.
Right.
We want to do what Jesus did by allowing him to live in us and through us. And the only way that can happen is if we have these perfect hearts toward God, as we have submitted ourselves to the redemption plan of God. We have an undivided allegiance to God and his way. What's God's way? His way is Calvary.
Amen.
His way is the cross.
Yeah.
Say, well, brother, you know, I accepted Christ when I got saved, and I understood the cross when I got born again. Well, that's how you live the Christian life, the same way, through the power of the cross.
Right.
The preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us who are saved and being saved, it is the cross, it is the power of God Almighty.
Amen.
You want power? You got to go to Calvary. I thought it was the Holy Spirit. You don't get the Holy Spirit working on your behalf and flowing through you. It's like we're trying to get the Holy Spirit to work in us and the Holy Spirit to do things. And all you have to do is have your faith in the proper place in Christ and his finished work. And legally, the Holy Spirit will automatically work on your behalf.
Right.
You don't have to beg them. You don't have to pray to them. And it concerns me, Christians who pray to the Holy Spirit. You know, Holy Spirit, we need your help. Well, if you're not going God's way and you're not submitting to his redemption plan, then he can't help you.
That's right.
Legally, he cannot help. As much as you pray, as much as Holy Spirit help me, Spirit of God help me, he's saying, I can't. I can't. It's a spiritual law that I cannot violate. The only way that I can help you is if you submit to the cross.
you.
Right.
If you submit your life, your heart to the blood of Christ, and you live that way, if you'll do that, put your faith completely, entirely in that, then the door is wide open, and I will help you in every capacity of your life.
Glory.
It's like we're trying to make the Holy Spirit, trying to make it happen, trying to conjure it up, and trying to sing enough songs and do enough things, whatever, to try to get the Holy Spirit to work on our behalf. And He simply, legally cannot do it outside of the parameters of the finished work of Calvary. For it's the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. You want the Spirit of life to work in you? It's in Christ Jesus by what He did at Calvary's cross. And now the Holy Spirit, I like to say it this way. It may sound a little... I don't know what it'll sound like to you, but the Holy Spirit will be all over you when you go God's way. He will. I'm serious. He'll be overwhelming you. Along with that comes conviction, though.
Yes, sir.
The Holy Spirit is the one who convicts us of sin, of righteousness, and of judgment. So if you want the Spirit of God working on your behalf, you've got to go the way of God. You go the way of God, and He will automatically, legally, He will work on your behalf. So, first thing is, if we're going to be those who will stand in the gap, those who will be the prayer warriors, the ones that God will use in these last days, we have to have perfect hearts, submitted to His redemption plan. Let's look at 2 Chronicles, go back a few chapters, a few pages. 7:14, most of you can quote it. 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people, my people, His people under the new covenant are those who have perfect hearts. His people are those who have submitted to Christ in the finished work. His people are those who are washed in the blood of Christ. That's His people. If my people, that's you. If you're born again and you're washed in the blood of Christ, that's you. Yes. If my people, which are called by my name, you are His people, you are called by His name. That means this. It means you are in covenant with Him.
Right.
You're in covenant with Him. And you have access to all that His name affords. Everything that He has. For the child of God is found in His name, in His covenant. His names testify of and speak of who He is to you in covenant. He's your Jehovah Sidkenu, your righteousness. He's your Jehovah Makadesh, your sanctifier. He's your Jehovah Shalom, your peace. He's your Jehovah Shammah, the ever-present God who's always with you. He's your Jehovah Rapha. He's your healer. That's His name. He's your Jehovah Jireh. He's your provider. He's your Jehovah Nissi. That means He's your victory banner. He's your Jehovah Rohi. That means He's your shepherd. Everything that you have need of is found in His name. And you are called by His name. You are in covenant with Him. Glory, that's you. My people, called by my name. And then He says this, if you humble yourself. Humble yourself. Humility simply means this, that I can't do it, but God can. The Bible says that God gives grace to who?
The humble.
Who does He resist? The proud. The proud man just says, you know, I don't need to go God's way. I don't need to submit to God's way because I can do it myself. I can be holy. I'm talking about Christians. Christians can be full of pride. Christians can say, I can perform. Christians can say, I can make myself holy. Christians can say, I can sanctify myself. Christians say, I can make myself righteous by what I do, by how I perform. That's Christians. That's pride. The humble Christian who recognizes that they need the grace of God, and God will give it to the humble. We need the grace of God, folks.
Amen.
You don't have what it takes.
Amen.
I don't care how good you may think you are, how holy you may think you are, how righteous you may think you are, you're not.
Right.
We need the grace of God. We need the righteousness of Christ. We need His holiness. We need His sanctifying grace operating within our lives. And if we'll humble ourselves, then He will give us the grace that we need to be what He's called us to be. So He's looking for those who will humble themselves, submit to His way. Submit to His way and you'll have a perfect heart. Submit to His way, you'll have a pure heart. Submit to His way, you'll have a true heart. It's all about going the way of God. So if my people, that's us, called by my name, in covenant with Him, that's us. Now this is what we have to do. Humble ourselves. We'll humble themselves. And then we have to pray. Folks, if there's ever a time that we needed to pray, it's now. We need to pray.
Amen.
I'm convinced that most Christians don't pray, don't have a consistent prayer life, because they're not full of God's Spirit.
There you go.
Come on. I'm convinced of that. Because if you, listen, if you are full, controlled, be not drunk with wine, Paul said, Ephesians 5:18, but be filled, be being filled, be controlled moment by the Spirit of God. If you are filled full of the Spirit of God is the great intercessor. Amen? And if you're full of Him, there is going to be a spirit of prayer that will rise up in you, really, on a continual basis. And going to the prayer meeting and having a prayer time is not going to be a difficult thing. It's going to be a natural thing for you to do. In fact, even in your everyday life, when you're driving down the road by yourself, when you're doing whatever you're doing, your everyday activities, you can be and should be, if you're full of the Holy Ghost, in an attitude and a spirit of prayer. I'm not standing here as one who has arrived to that, but I do notice that more and more, as I submit myself to God's redemption plan, yield to Christ and His finished work, and the Holy Spirit is filling me, and I'm living a Spirit-filled, Spirit-controlled life, I find the spirit of prayer just kind of constantly there.
Amen.
It's not that I have to be on my knees and I have to be mouthing words all the time, but I shared this the other night. There's times when I'm sitting in front of my TV trying to watch a television program, a football game, a golf match or whatever, a race or whatever, certain things that I like to watch. And it's like I'm looking at the TV, but I'm really not watching it because there's just something just welling up in me. And I'm just kind of under my breath. I'm not making a big deal out of it, but it's just there. It's just there. Driving down the road by myself, it's just there. I'll find myself just speaking in tongues. You know, it's not like I consciously have, oh man, I gotta pray, I gotta speak in tongues. No, it's something when you're full of the Holy Ghost, and the more you live the Spirit-filled life, it will just be there.
Amen.
So I'm convinced that people who can't pray, the reason why they can't pray is because they're not full of the Holy Ghost, the one who is the great intercessor.
Amen.
Amen. He intercedes for you, the Bible says, Romans chapter 8, with groanings, amen,
right,
which cannot be uttered. So prayer should be a lifestyle. Yes, we should have our set prayer times. You should have a time consistently, however often that is, that you get alone with God and you spend time with God. And there should be corporate prayer. That should be a real thing. That should be a powerful thing that you do. But it also should be a lifestyle. You should live and walk in a spirit of prayer. And we can do that if we're filled and full of the Holy Ghost. So we need to be a people of prayer. You know, it grieves me when I go to, and I say this all the time, people probably get tired of hearing it, but when I go to a corporate prayer meeting, and when I go to a corporate prayer meeting, I come to pray. To open my mouth. So when you come to a corporate prayer, it's not time for you to have your little quiet time. Do that at home. Come to the prayer meeting as one who is full of the Holy Ghost with a burden and begin to pray.
That's it.
You say, well, I don't have anything. Praise Him. Say hallelujah. Praise God. Whatever. But open your mouth.
Come on.
And pray. And man, some of the most powerful church services that I have had have been prayer meetings. When there would be a group of people who really pray. Who come with a burden, and as you hear the burden of the saints, you now can enter into that burden and agree with them, and the Holy Spirit can even now, you know, build on that, and then another one, the Spirit will burden them to pray maybe along the same lines, but to go further with it or whatever. But it can be a powerful thing, but we have to be willing when we gather together to pray. Pray. If you're going to have your quiet time, do that at home. Do it at home. Anyhow, that's just something that I notice. It bothers me because I know how powerful it can be when God's people really come to pray.
Right.
Really come to pray and open their mouths and pray. It can be like in Acts chapter 4, when they prayed, the place where they were assembled was shaken.
Yes.
And that wasn't some, you know, earthquake, natural earthquake. I believe that place was shaken from the rumble of their voices crying out to God. I've been in some prayer meetings where it was like almost like the rafters were shaken. As people were crying out to God, and it can be a very powerful thing. So we need to pray. And then he says, as Pastor emphasized, at the beginning of the service, seek my face. Much of our prayer needs to be focused on and geared towards seeking the face of God.
Amen, bro.
Seeking the face of God, what that means is you are seeking Him for who He is. Not so much what He can do, but you are seeking Him for who He is. God, I just want to know You. God, I just want fellowship with You. God, I want to experience You in a greater way. I want to know You in a deeper way. I want to have a greater relationship with You.
Yes.
Just expressing to Him, God, I just want You.
Yes.
Seek His face. And then, this probably one of the keys here to us being what we need to be as intercessors, turn from their wicked ways. Now, that's repentance. If there's one thing that the church needs to do, it needs to repent.
Amen.
Now, repentance, well, first of all, let me do this. Wicked ways does not have to do with acts of sin. Get it out of your mind. It's what I always thought. Wicked ways, you think of a particular acts of sin, all right, that need to be turned from it. Of course they do, but that's not the core problem. Wicked ways, when you look that up in the Hebrew, ways, wicked ways, it has to do with paths trodden and paths and directions that one goes that is contrary to God's covenant.
Right.
In other words, this, very simply, any way that is contrary to Jesus Christ and His finished work is a wicked way.
Amen.
If you are in a works righteousness mentality, my friend, that is a wicked way. If you're trying to be what God has called you to be by the latest 10-step program or the 21 days of this or the whatever, 10 steps to this, all of these things, these programs that you see coming through the church, if that is your way to try to be and find your purpose and be what God has called you to be, that's a wicked way. It's wicked. Why is it wicked? Because it's contrary to God's covenant and the way that He has lined out and laid out in His Word. And the way laid out in His Word is simply this: deny yourself.
There you go.
Take up the cross.
Jesus.
And follow after Him. Lose your life that you may find my life, Jesus. That's the way that God has laid out in His Word. So, repentance is something that the church needs to experience. True repentance.
Yes,
sir. I like to say it this way, that confession of sin, and we need to confess our sin according to 1 John 1 and 9, that's believers. Confession will get you forgiveness. Repentance will get you the kingdom. What I mean by that is this. Repentance means that you are going in a wrong direction, all right? You're living in a way that is contrary to God's covenant and God's way, and you recognize that, you repent, you do an about face, and you now say, Lord, I'm going Your way. I recognize that your way is Calvary. I recognize that your way is the blood. And I am going your way. You do that, my friend, and you'll get the kingdom. It's God's good pleasure to give it to you. The kingdom. The kingdom meaning God's rule, God's reign, God's dominion in your life. The kingdom meaning power. The kingdom of God is not in word, but in power. The kingdom of God is not in meat and drink, but it's in righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. God longs to give that to His children, but we need to repent. Because we're going, the majority of the church needs to repent of the direction and the way that it is going that is contrary to God's way. And if we'll do that, then this is what God will do. Then, I will hear from heaven. He's not going to hear from heaven otherwise. If we don't, God's people, called by His name, if we don't humble ourselves, if we don't pray, if we don't seek His face, if we don't repent of the wicked way that we are ways, that we are going, the paths that we are going down that are contrary to God's path, which is Calvary, then God will not hear us.
There you go.
I wonder how many prayers that people pray that God isn't hearing. He's not hearing them. Because He says, then I will hear from Him. You do this thing right according to the way that I have aligned in my word, and you do it according to my covenant, then I will hear from heaven. And then things will begin to happen, my friend.
Yes.
He says, I'll forgive sin.
Yes.
I'll forgive sin. And I'll heal your land. Pastor said, we got a lot of land that needs. I'm not talking about our nation. Right. No, personally, right. We have land that needs to be healed. I'm talking about in our families.
Yes.
We have land that needs to be healed.
Right.
I'm talking about in our churches. We have land that needs to be healed. And yes, our nation and the nations of the world need healing. But it's not going to happen if we don't have perfect hearts by going God's way. If we don't, as God's people in covenant with Him, if we don't humble ourselves, pray, seek His face, turn from our wicked ways, the direction we're going that's contrary to God's covenant, if we don't do that, then God won't forgive, God won't heal. I want you, but I want God to forgive, and I want God to heal. That means that God will move on your behalf. Amen? I believe a whole lot more that He'll do. And just those two were mentioned there, but there's a whole lot more, and that probably encapsulates everything that God does. But there are requirements. There are requirements. And God is not able to do what He can do and desires to do because we are the hindrance.
That's right.
We're the hindrance. We don't have perfect hearts. We don't have pure hearts. We don't have true hearts. We're not repenting. We're not going God's way. We're not submitting to His redemption plan the way that we should. The majority of the church isn't. And because of that, God is not able to move. I believe that we are in the mess that we are in our lives, our families, our churches, in our nation, the nations of the world, is because we have rejected, ultimately, God's redemption plan. We've embraced everything but. We've embraced the purpose-driven thing, the New Agey thing, the psychology thing, and all of this garbage that's in the church that's trying to take the place of God's way and God's plan and take the place of the cross. And because of that, God's hands are tied. You know that God, the sovereign Lord of glory, His hands can be tied to where He can't move. He could if He wanted to, but He chooses to be somewhat subject to His creatures because of our free will in what He does in this earth, at least now in this dispensation of grace that we live in.
Yes,
I mean, God could just snap His fingers and He could save everyone. We could just be all like robots and serve Him, but that's not the way He operates.
Right.
He chooses to, in a sense, make Himself vulnerable to our will, if you will, when it comes to what He does in this earth and this dispensation of grace that we live in. I know that may sound odd to you, but it's the reality. Now, when it comes to His plan, He's going to do what He's going to do.
I mean, when it's time for that trumpet to sound and Jesus is ready, that's going to happen no matter what, no matter what you do. But in this dispensation of grace that we live in, God chooses. The Bible says that we are co-laborers with Him. Laborers with God, co-laborers with Christ. We are working with God. And if we don't do our part, the work don't get done. If we don't submit and we don't do it the way that God has laid it out in His Word, it doesn't get done. So, the eyes of the Lord, listen, are running to and fro throughout this earth, looking for hearts that are perfect toward Him, that He may be strong in the behalf of those whose hearts are perfect toward Him.
Yes.
If my people, which are called by my name, will humble themselves, pray, seek my face, turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven.
Right.
Then I will forgive sin. Then I will heal your life. God wants to do great things. It's up to us. How are we going to respond? How are we going to respond? Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you for your word, Lord. Lord, I reject any spirit of condemnation in this house, Lord. I don't want anyone to be under condemnation. But Lord, we all welcome conviction, Lord.
Yes.
If your spirit is convicting us, Lord, where we have failed in the sense of not submitting to what you have provided and what you have given to us at Calvary, Lord, we welcome the conviction of your spirit, Lord. Father, we want to be everything that you have called us to be as your children, Lord. Father, we want you to move in our midst. We want you to move in these last days, Father.
Yes.
We want to see
yes. A
great move of your spirit, Lord, a great reformation, a great revival, Lord God, a great harvest
yes. Brought
forth. That, Lord, that we would be the church that you have called us to be, the church of power, the church of glory, the church that is submitted to your hand, Lord, the church that you can use as instruments of righteousness, Lord. Oh, hallelujah. As yielded vessels, Heavenly Father, Lord, we just say that we love you. We thank you. We praise you for all that you've done and all that you have given. We give you praise. We give you honor. We give you glory. I don't know if we can maybe sing. Yeah, go ahead, brother. Just as you feel led, Lord, I trust your leading. And let's just stand to our feet for a few moments. I know it's late, so we want to get going, but let's just worship the Lord for a few moments. And if you want to come to this front as a to this altar, just a step of faith, and you want the Lord to do something in you, these altars are open, or just in your pew, and just worship Him. Thank you.
Let us not lift our souls to another.
Yeah. that it's not going anywhere. Church, we have to look inside. In those two verses that he quoted tonight, there's a two-letter word, if. That is one powerful two-letter word, if. If my people. And that was confirmation today. Brother David and I did not talk about what he was going to preach on tonight. I didn't know. I don't do that. I was seeking the Lord today. He laid that verse on my heart. That ought to tell you something, church. That's the Spirit of the living God wanting to bring the church back. The Holy Spirit showing us we better get to that cross and we better stay there.
Right. Right.
That's why, again, many of our prayers are not answered.
Amen.
Oh, that word if. Oh, were you blessed tonight?
Amen.
I believe the Holy Spirit was here. I know. I sat back there in the back and I was thoroughly blessed. Brother Henderson, were you blessed, church, tonight?
Amen.
Thank you so much for coming. We will be taking up a love offering for Brother David and Sister Martha. It's right over there in that little box. Those of you that come here before, you know how we do it. But we hope to see you tomorrow night at 6:30. I think it's just going to get better.
Amen.
If we come ready. If we come prepared, not just to come in here and warm that pew, and actually it was pretty hot in here for a while, so anyway, sorry about that. We got the air conditioner, I think, settled down tonight. But come prepared, and that means seek the face of the Lord. If my people seek Him, and come prepared to bless Him tomorrow and be blessed. Amen.
Amen.
Does anybody else have anything they need to say tonight? Thank you so much for those of you at home. We love you. Most importantly, Jesus loves you. And if you will, just call upon the name. All those that call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It's that quick and that simple. Again, anybody else got anything tonight? You have a special prayer request? You'd like to see me after church or Brother David? Feel free to do so. I know some people would like to just discuss things one-on-one, and we'll be happy to visit with you, okay? Brother
Stacy. Hi, for Stacy.
Stacy.
Yes. Brother Stacy Henderson is in, which is Tate's father, he is in Shreveport Hospital. The other night, Wednesday night, I got a call and ran up to the hospital in Jackson Parish, and he was running high fever. They run a lot of different tests, etc., and found out that he had an infection. And Tate, you jump in here and correct me if I'm wrong, but your mom led us to believe late today he's in Shreveport. They still don't know what the originator of the infection was, but they have pumped him full of antibiotics and whatever else they do in the hospital, and he is doing much better. He is out of ICU and into a regular room. Do I have that right, son? But there is a spot, okay, on his lung. Is that right? Do I have that right? Okay. And they are going to go through and do an additional MRI, I believe, and then we'll go from there. But our God is able. That's what me and Brother Henderson were praying about tonight, is interceding for Brother Stacy Henderson. Because I'll tell you, he and his wife Annette would be sitting right back there tonight if he wasn't in the hospital. And they are dear, precious people. And I think it's evident by the life that this young man leads. I'm proud of that boy right there. And I know, Grandpa, you are too, but I am proud of that boy. Amen. Anybody else got anything? Brother Henderson, would you dismiss us in prayer tonight, please, brother?
Father, we come tonight rejoicing in our hearts.
Yes.
For the movement of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Father, we thank you for speaking to our hearts. Not only speaking to our hearts, but the guidance of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Father, continue to pray for this church and our six churches.
Yes.
Father, we need to get back, get fired up, and let the world know that our God is alive and He's still in control.
Ooh, yes.
Father, we want to thank you for the answered prayers that you have bestowed upon us. Father, we still have many that it needs to be spoken to, and hey, we know they're going to take miracles. But Father, we know tonight that you're still in miracle business.
Yes.
And Father, we have that faith as that mustard seed that we can move mountains because of our Almighty
God.
Father, I ask you to be with them tomorrow night and Sunday in the movement. I enjoy coming tonight, even touching my heart, uplifting me spiritually and physically. Keep me focused and to stay focused upon the man named Jesus Christ. Father, continue to bless every heart now as we assemble in this pen. And Father, if there's someone out there lost, that he died, we know they'll go to hell. Father, let us go and see them and let them know that we have a revival that's filled by the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
And he wants to do miracles for each and every one of them. And we praise you and thank you for that. We thank you for what you've done now.
Yes.
And Father, we give you all the glory and the praise for it.
Yes.
Thank you for the song service, the fellowship,
yes,
of the movement of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
And Father, we rejoice and our hearts are bled and our cup overrunneth.
Yes.
Father, and thank you, Father, in all these things, in the things that you have in store.
Yes.
Jesus' precious holy name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.